Legal dictation start in 10 seconds, 5 seconds, start. The court may of course presume as mentioned in S114 of the Indian Evidence Act the existence of any fact which it thinks likely to have happened, regard being had to the common course of natural events. Human conduct and public and private business in their relation to the facts of the particular case. The illustrations mentioned in that section, though taken from different spheres of human activity, are not exhaustive. They are based upon human experience and have to be applied in the context of the facts of each case. The illustrations are merely examples of circumstances in which certain presumptions may be met. Other presumptions of similar kind in similar circumstances can be made under the provisions of the section itself. Whether or not a presumption can be drawn under the section in a particular case depends ultimately upon the facts and circumstances of each case. No hard and fast rule can be laid down. Another golden thread which runs through the web of the administration of justice in criminal cases is that if two views are possible on the evidence adduced in the case, one pointing to the guilt of the accused and the other to his innocence, the view which is favorable to the accused should be adopted. This principle has a special relevance in cases wherein the guilt of the accused is sought to be established by circumstantial evidence. Rule has accordingly been laid down that unless the evidence adduced in the case is consistent only with the hypothesis of the guilt of the accused and is inconsistent with that of his innocence, the court should refrain from according a finding of guilt of the accused. It is also an accepted rule that in case the court entertains reasonable doubt regarding the guilt of the accused must have the benefit of that doubt. Of course, the doubt regarding the guilt of the accused should be reasonable. It is not the doubt of a mind which is either so vacillating that it is incapable of reaching a firm conclusion or so timid that it is hesitant and afraid to take things to their neutral consequences. The rule regarding the benefit of doubt also does not warrant acquittal of the accused. By resort to surmises, conjectures, or fanciful considerations, there has to be clear evidence of the guilt of the accused, and in the absence of that, it is not possible to record a finding of his guilt. In arriving at the conclusion about the guilt of the accused charged with the commission of a crime, the court has to judge the evidence by the yardstick of probabilities. It is intrinsic worth and the animus of witnesses. Every case in the final analysis would have to depend upon its own facts. Although the benefit of every reasonable doubt should be given to the accused, the courts should not at the same time reject evidence which is ex face trustworthy on grounds which are fanciful or in the nature of conjectures. The guilt of the accused has to be adjudged not by the fact that a vast number of people believe him to be guilty, but whether his guilt has been established by the evidence brought on record. Indeed, the courts have hardly any other yardstick or material to adjudge the guilt of the person arranged as accused. Reference is something made to the class of public interest and that of the individual accused. The conflict in this respect is more apparent than real. In a murder trial, when an accused person stands charged with the commission. If you like video, please click on the subscribe button.